Hi guys!
In today's video, we're going to recap two major ideas that we have learned in the previous lesson. First of which is going to be on salt hydrolysis, and the second one is going to be on a buffer solution. So let's take a look at the notes over here on page 59 to recap how we're going to calculate the pH of a salt. Now, the example over here is using sodium ethanoate, and the first thing that you have to do is always to understand if this salt is an acidic or a basic salt. And the idea over here is to always work backwards to take a look at the acid or the base that you use to neutralize to get the salt. So William, can you tell me what acid or base did you use to get this particular sodium ethanoate?
Right, the key is really for us to kind of work backwards, right? So when you look at Na+, now Na+ would have come from NaOH.
That's right.
And NaOH should be a strong base.
That's right.
Therefore, Na+ will be classified as a weak conjugate acid.
That's right.
And ethanoate will come from ethanoic acid.
Right.
Ethanoic acid is a weak acid. So ethanoate will be a strong conjugate base.
That's right. Now, between the two ions that we see over here, who should we be focusing on?
Always focus on the strong guy.
That's right. So it will be the ethanoic ion. The reason why is because the ethanoic ion will undergo a hydrolysis reaction where it is going to react with water in a reversible reaction. So that is going to be the first step they're going to do. Write down the reversible equation. And William, can you remind me again, right? What does a base do?
Well, a base is always going to grab proton, and this time around, it's going to grab proton from water.
That's right. And as a result, you're going to form the OH minus. And that is exactly the reason why we say that the salt is a basic salt. Now, moving on to calculations, right? The first step will also include the setting up of the ice table, where you're going to let X be the amount of ethanoate ion that has dissociated or undergone hydrolysis. And we're going to establish the equilibrium concentrations. Now, into step two, we'll need to use these equilibrium concentrations and sub it in into a dissociation constant. Now, William, knowing that your ethanoic ion is a basic salt, right? Can you tell me what kind of dissociation constant you should be using?
A basic salt should require Kb expression.
Right, but the question only gave me a Ka value. What should we do instead?
Well, we have to find Kb by using the formula Ka times Kb equals to Kw. Reason being, these two are conjugate base pair.
That's right. So in this case, we have to make Kb the subject of the formula. Summing in the values, you should be able to get the value for Kb as well. Now, what is the purpose of the Kb? Obviously, it is to sub in these equilibrium concentrations into the Kb, and you realize the entire equation only has X as an unknown. Obviously, you have to solve them, and solving them will allow you to find out what is the OH minus concentration. That is important because the moment I go up to the last step, step three, this is step four, you're going to use the definition of pOH to calculate the pOH value and subsequently the pH value. Wow, sounds like a mouthful, William. Can you give me a shortcut instead?
Yes, right. Guys, remember there's a way for you to bypass the ice table. Everything is summarized for us last week, right? So the first thing you must always tell yourself is, are we working with acidic salts or are we working with basic salt? So we have nicely written down the summary for you below. If you're working with acidic salts, key thing is to find Ka, right? Which is Kw divided by Kb, and just apply that formula, right? pH is negative log square root concentration of Ka times the Ka times the concentration of the salt, right? And there's another formula for basic salts. We have to find the Kb expression, and then we'll find pOH using the formula that's written. So this is a shortcut that will allow us to bypass the ice table.
Now you notice that these formulas are actually very similar to that of the weak acid, weak base. The only difference is that instead of dealing with the concentration of the salt, in that case, you're going to deal with the concentration of the acids instead.
That's right.
Now moving on to the next concept, William, we're going to talk about buffer solutions now. Now, can you pretend that I'm a six-year-old and explain to me in the most simplest term, what do you understand by a buffer solution?
Okay, for the records, I do think you look like a six-year-old.
Thank you very much.
So I'm going to do my best and explain to you as if you're a six-year-old kid. All right, so guys, I think we spent a lot of time trying to explain to you how buffers work last week. I'm going to use this PowerPoint annotation to try to illustrate this. Right, so you can see over here, we did mention to you guys that the job of a buffer is there to resist any H plus or OH minus when it's being added into the solution. And we always mention that in a buffer, there are two equations that matters. All right, the first equation is that of the weak acid. So weak acid is going to be partially dissociated. Now from there, you have to identify this thing which we always term as the major species, all right? So who is the major species in this case will be the ethanoic acid, because it's a weak acid, dissociation is very low. And then for the second equation, you have to look at the salt. Now the salt, just bear in mind, is going to be a full dissociation. So the major species we are looking at is going to be this. Okay, so one way that can make your understanding a little bit easier is to see the major species as if they are like, what, soldiers, right? So Mr. Leung, you know, we serve NS, right?
Yes.
So, you know, why do we serve NS?
To defend our nation.
Yeah, to defend against our nation, all right? To defend
our nation,
defend our nation, all right? Now, so you can imagine, right? See them as soldiers, and what do soldiers do, right? So you see there's a war cry that's coming out, right? So they have to defend, but who do they defend against? They're gonna defend against any H plus or OH minus that enters the solution to make sure that the pH of our homeland is more or less the same. Okay, we're gonna deep dive a little bit into this. Okay, suppose no enemies is invading us right now, okay? The country is at peace, everybody is happy, okay? But one fine day, all right, one fine day, there is this enemy that decides to invade our country, right? Mm-hmm. Which is called H+. Right, so H+ enters our terrain right now, everybody is on red alert. So if H+ enemy comes in, one of our soldiers must react to this, right? So who is gonna react to this?
So H plus must react with the conjugate base. So I believe here will be the actinoid ion.
Alright, so you can imagine this kind of army is going to be activated. It's now going to react to the H plus. And what do? They're going to surround the enemy. All the H plus enemy dies. So the pH of the solution, and in this case our country, remains more or less the same. Okay, likewise, if we have OH minus entering our terrain, right? So this is an enemy, another army gets activated, and this time round it becomes?
It'll be the weak acid, which is going to be the actinoid acid.
Alright, so the actinoid acid army is now going to counter against OH minus, same thing happens, OH minus enemy will die, and the pH of the solution is going to remain more or less unchanged. Okay, I know it's a very lame example, but it kind of gets a message across. What do we do in exams? We focus on the major species. The major species are the soldiers, and their job is to defend against H plus or OH minus that enters our solution.
That's right. So now, can I summarize this for you by going back to the notes on buffer solution? The example that we used was what we call an acidic buffer because we are dealing with an acid, a weak acid, as well as its own conjugate base. So let me just box up the two most important species over here, the actinoid acid as well as the conjugate base over here, right? So like what Mr. Williams said, in the event that there is going to be an enemy, let's say the enemy is H+, a small amount of H+ has invaded our country. William, share with me again, what is the thing that is going to defend our country?
Your conjugate base army is going to come in.
That's right. So it's going to neutralize your H+. At the end of the day, your pH will remain fairly constant. Now, on the other hand, the other enemy, which is OH minus, if they come in to invade, who is going to come in to save our country?
That will be the acidic army that will come in.
So it will be the weak acid that's reacting, and as a result, your pH will once again remain fairly constant. Now, just to warn you guys a little bit, in exam, whenever you write these equations, they must all be written with a full arrow, because these are all full neutralization reactions. Now, taking a little bit more of a mathematical approach, how are we going to calculate the pH of an acidic buffer? The formula is given by here. You'll notice that pH is going to be dependent on the ratio of the acid as well as its own conjugate, right? So we have to take a look at how much of these two species are inside the solution to calculate the pH of that solution. Now, William, let me go back to your analogy of an army now, right?
All right.
So if I want to defend our country the best, what do you think will be the ratio or the amount of both armies that should be in our country?
Okay, if I'm a defense minister, I have to allocate resources, and now we have two groups of army, right?
Okay.
So suppose we only have the land army and also the air force.
Okay.
Too bad don't have navy, right?
Okay.
So to defend against the enemies, right, to be equally strong, I think I have to dedicate 50-50 resources towards the land side and as well as the air side as well. So the best way to defend against all sorts of enemy is to make sure that things are in a 50-50 ratio.
Okay, I think that's a very good strategy. I think you can take over the Minister of Defense. Very well done. So in the context of the acidic buffer, what we are really saying is that we are going to have equal amounts of both the acid as well as the conjugate base. So the concentrations must be equal. And mathematically speaking, you'll realize that this ratio will now be equals to 1. And everybody knows that from math, log 1 is going to be 0, which means that the second term essentially disappears. You're going to be left with a much simpler equation. So once again, this equation, even though it's simple, it can only be done under this very special scenario where your buffer is able to resist pH changes the best. That whole scenario is what we call a maximum buffer capacity.
That's right.
Now, William, I watched this video over here, right? And I noticed that you can do quite a bit of pull-ups. Eh? Can you tell me within 30 seconds how many pull-ups you can do?
I can do about 1,000 pull-ups.
Sure not.
Yeah.
I think from my age, right, doesn't seem like it, you know. I believe if you were to try to do it, I think by the time you do 5 pull-ups, right, I think you will get a bit more lethargy already.
Hey, for the records, I'm still quite young, okay? I'm only 21 this year.
At heart. But I think what's going to happen is, I feel that if you have, if you are working out a lot, you'll start to see that your muscles is going to produce a lot of lactic acid from anaerobic respiration, and that is going to cause your blood to be more acidic than usual. So it sounds like you're going to faint very quickly. Like.
Well, actually, I don't, right? I can go on forever, right? I will not faint. And what is the reason why when we, let's say, do exercise and our body is able to get rid of the acid that's being produced, it's actually because our blood in our body actually consists of a buffer solution.
Okay.
Right, so I'm going to explain this to you why I don't faint during the process of exercise.
Sure.
Okay, so let's take a look at our notes. All the details are over there. Right, so if you look at your notes, you will notice there is a point that says our human body comprises of a combination of H2CO3 as well as HCO3-. This is the buffer that's already set up in a human body. Right, so when we have these two, our job is to identify who is the acid, who is the conjugate base, and how do we do that again?
So we look at the two components and we see which one has more hydrogen atoms. Mm-hmm. That will usually be the acid. So in this context, your H2CO3, known as carbonic acid, will be the weak acid, and HCO3-, known as the hydrogen carbonate ion, will be the conjugate base.
Alright, so we have the conjugate pair system in place, and remember, their job is to defend against the enemy. So in this case, our weak acid, the job is to buffer against any incoming OH-, and then the conjugate base is there to defend against any incoming H+. Mm. Right, so you can see that our human body is actually well equipped to counter any H+ or OH- that's going to enter our solution or our blood. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in an event, let's say OH- enters our bloodstream. Mm-hmm. Now what's going to happen? It will get removed quite effectively. So you can see there's an equation over here. So this equation is trying to explain when OH- enters our bloodstream, it will be countered by H2CO3, the acidic soldier, right? So as it counters that OH-, the pH of our solution or our blood is going to be more or less unchanged.
Mm,
okay, so this is if you have OH-.
Sure.
So back to our pull-up analogy.
Sure.
That means H+ is entering because lactic acid is building up. Mm-hmm. Now, how does our body remove the lactic acid or the H+? It's now using the help of HCO3-, the conjugate base. So you can see that there's an equation over here, right? So this equation is trying to explain to us the conjugate base will be countering the H3O+ that's entering the solution. And once it reacts with H3O+, you're going to form H2CO3. And you also notice something, right? When we exercise heavily, what happens?
For you, I think you'll pant a lot heavily, more heavier, and you realize that your breathing rate is going to increase.
So you don't pant?
I don't, yes.
Oh, okay, you're super fit. All right, okay, so for me, okay, I'm going to pant. All right, so why do I pant during the process of exercise? It's because my body needs to remove that HCO3 that's building up. Now, what happens is everything is now going to be focused on the lungs. You can see there's another equation below. H2CO3 will be changed into carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide is going to be removed by the lungs. So you can visualize the whole process as we're trying to exercise. Yes, we have anaerobic respiration, we have H+ that's building up, but then the buffer inside our bloodstream is more than capable of removing the H+. Mm. So 1,000 pull-up, no problem.
Thank you very much, William. We know that you are also very fit, lah. So in summary, I mean, just for interesting facts, because our body or our blood realized that there's a lot more scenarios where lactic acid is going to join in. So a lot of the H+ is coming to attack. That is why our body has adapted such that the hydrogen carbonate ion will always be in larger proportion as compared to the H2CO3. So in general, it's about 20 times more than the H2CO3.
Cinderella, I have a ball to attend tonight, and I need a new dress to impress my knight in shining armor.
Alright, Cinderella, what color of a dress would you like?
Let me start off with a green dress, can I?
Okay, I'm gonna give you a green dress.
Sure.
Now, fairy godmother is going to grant you your wish, and how am I gonna do that? your wish shall be granted through the colors of the water. So as I pour the water in, whatever color that comes out is gonna be the color of a dress. All right, let's do it.
But it looks maybe you look very fat, you know?
Yeah.
I want a different color dress. How about a purple color one?
Cinderella, you're very muffin. But it's okay, I'm gonna help you. Your wish shall be granted through the colors of my water.
Last one. I want a red color dress.
Okay, last time I'm helping you. Alright, I'm off free later. Okay, now your wish shall be granted through the colors of the water.
I look thin now. Thank you very much, fairy godmother.
You're welcome.
Can you tell me what kind of black magic you are doing in this?
No, a fairy godmother will never tell you her secrets. But your tutors will. See you in class.